The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Reverend Heather Kirk Davidoff of Westminster Presbyterian Church will deliver today's invocation.
Holy God, we invite your presence and your power into this chamber this afternoon. None of us are here in this room on our own. Behind each of us are our families, our communities, our friends and mentors who support us and hold us accountable. We call them to mind now. Behind each of the elected officials here today are millions of constituents, each with their stories and dreams, their challenges and their gifts. We call them to mind now. In this room are the memories of the people who have come before us, who have gathered in this room to forge agreements, state objections, to speak and to listen. We call them to mind now. None of us here in this room stands alone, Holy God. In these moments before our work begins, we call to mind all of those who stand with us, seen and unseen. May the work we do today be a credit to those who have raised us and shaped us. May the work we do today be an honest service to those who we represent, especially the most vulnerable. May the work we do today honor those who came before us in this room and all of those who have labored to create and to uphold our democracy. And may the work we do today give glory to you, Holy God. Inspire us to speak clearly, enable us to listen well, and empower us to discern wisely. And let the people say, Amen.
Reading of the journal.
In Senate, Sunday, February 21st, 2021, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Saturday, February 20th, 2021, was read and approved. On motion, Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions. Messages from the Assembly. Messages from the Governor. Reports of standing committees. Reports of select committees. Communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator Gianaris.
Madam President, on behalf of Senator Addabbo, I wish to call up Senate Print 1463, recalled from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 88, Senate Print 1463 by Senator Addabbo, an act to amend Chapter 473 of the laws of 2010, amending the racing, parimutuel wagering, and breeding law.
Consider the vote by which this bill was passed.
Secretary, recall the roll. Secretary, recall the roll on reconsideration.
Addabbo, Gianaris, Kruger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White. Aye, 63.
Following amendments.
The amendments are received.
Thank you, Madam President. Amendments are also offered to the following third reading calendar bills. Sponsored by Senator Gianaris on page 12, calendar 119, Senate Print 1034, and on behalf of Senator Parker on page 17, calendar 197, Senate Print 1579.
The amendment is received and the bill shall retain its place in the third reading calendar.
I also move to commit the following calendar bills to the Committee on Rules, Senate Bill Numbers 598B, 612A, 553, 614B, 1783, 1784A, 3058, 3061A, and 3185.
So ordered.
At this time, can we take up previously adopted Resolution 353 by Senator Hinchey, read its title only, and recognize Senator Hinchey on the resolution.
Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution 353 by Senator Hinchey, mourning the death of Frances G. Tonko, beloved friend, mother, and pillar in her community.
Senator Hinchey on the resolution.
Thank you. Today, I have the honor of sponsoring the resolution which celebrates the life of Frances G. Tonko, a beloved Amsterdam community member who passed away in late January, just 2.5 months shy of her 100th birthday, leaving behind a beautiful lifelong legacy of service. Frances was a beacon of light to all who knew her. I've heard incredible stories about Frances through her son, my friend, and our federal colleague, Congressman Paul Tonko, of whom she was deeply proud. These stories include those of Frances buzzing around Amsterdam, collecting signatures, campaigning, and beaming with pride for the congressman back when he made history in Montgomery County as the youngest person ever elected to the county's Board of Supervisors. I know that both Frances and her late husband, Stanley, served as strong role models for Congressman Tonko and were grounding pillars of his campaigns throughout the years, supporting him every step of the way. Frances was a woman of many talents, and she distinguished herself by her sincere dedication to the welfare of her community as a member of St. Stanislaus Church and the Ladies' Rosary Society, St. Mary's Club 60, and as a past member of the Montgomery County Women's Democratic Club. And talk about dedication, she was also recognized by former Governor Mario Cuomo as New York Blood Donor of the Year. Above all, Frances loved her family, her friends, and her community. And while this great loss is felt by so many, we are incredibly lucky to have had her among us as a cherished friend and neighbor for all of her 99 years. Our thoughts and deepest condolences are with Frances's son, Congressman Tonko, her daughter, Patricia, and all of her family and loved ones. Thank you.
The resolution was previously adopted
on February 9th.
Senator Gianaris.
Madam President, a couple of weeks ago, Senator Hinchey had her first bill passed, and this was her first resolution. So let's congratulate Senator Hinchey.
Congratulations, Senator Hinchey, on your first resolution.
Request of the senator that resolution is open for co-sponsorship.
The resolution is open for co-sponsorship.
There will be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
There's an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
The Senate will stand at ease.
Senate will stand at ease. Senator Gianaris.
Madam President, is there a report of the Rules Committee at the desk?
There's a report of the Rules Committee at the desk. The Secretary will read.
Senator Stuart Cousins from the Committee on Rules reports the following bills. Senate Print 553 by Senator Sanders, an act to amend the public health law. Senate Print 598B by Senator May, an act in relation to enacting the Reimagining Long-Term Care Task Force. Senate Print 612A by Senator May, an act to amend the elder law. Senate Print 614B by Senator May, an act to amend the public health law and the social services law. Senate Print 830B by Senator Comrie, an act to amend the election law, the criminal procedure law, the executive law, and the correction law. Senate Print 1783 by Senator Skoufis, an act directing the Department of Health to establish and implement an infection inspection audit. Senate Print 1784A by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the social services law. Senate Print 3058 by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law. Senate Print 3061A by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law. Senate Print 3185 by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the public health law. Senate Print 3784A by Senator Comrie, an act to amend the public service law. Senate Print 4336A by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law. Senate Print 4681 by Senator Gonardes, an act to amend the retirement and Social Security law. Senate Print 4893 by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law. Senate Print 4960 by Senator Mayer, an act to amend the public service law. All bills report direct to third reading.
Move to accept the report of the Rules Committee.
All in favor of accepting the Committee on Rules report signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The report is accepted and before the House.
This time, Madam President, let's take up the reading of the calendar.
The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 83, Senate Print 546 by Senator Mayer, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 1st of September.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 84, Senate Print 912 by Senator Mayer, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect July 1st, 2021.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 84, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Borello, Boyle, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Matera, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rath, Ritchie, Serino, Steck, and White. Ayes 45, nays 18.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 86, Senate Print 1379 by Senator Brooks. An act to amend the general municipal law.
Read the last section.
Section 9, this act shall take effect on the 180th day after shall become law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Ready? Announce the results.
In relation to calendar number 86, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Krueger and White. Ayes 61, nays 2.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 103, Senate Print 192 by Senator Thomas, an act to amend the general business law.
The bill will be laid aside for today.
Calendar number 132, Senate Print 1138 by Senator Harkin, an act authorizing the Commissioner of General Services to convey real property in Westchester County.
There's a home rule message at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 193, Senate Print 1800 by Senator Savino, an act to amend the economic development law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 220, Senate Print 498 by Senator Brezin, an act to amend the insurance law.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 272, Senate Print 62 by Senator Passard, an act to amend the vehicle and traffic law.
Read the last section.
Section 6, this act shall take effect 1 year after shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 274, Senate Print 262 by Senator Myrie, an act to amend the highway law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 60th day of the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 274, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Borello, Boyle, Gallivan, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Matera, Oberacker, Ort, Palumbo, Rath, Ritchie, Serino, Steck, and White. Ayes 46, nays 17.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 291, Senate Print 3992 by Senator Reichlin Melnick, an act to amend the real property tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Janaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of today's calendar.
Can we please take up the supplemental calendar, Madam President?
The secretary will read.
Cal number 329, Senate Print 598B by Senator May, an act in relation to enacting the Reimagining Long-Term Care Task Force.
Substitution. Read the last section.
Section 6 is asked to take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator May to explain her vote.
Thank you, Madam President. You'll hear a lot from me today because this is a big day for those of us who've been working on nursing homes. I want to thank the leadership. I want to thank my colleagues on both sides of the aisle. I want to thank my colleagues in the Assembly. And I especially want to thank all the groups and individuals who have come forward and told their tragic stories in order to keep the tragedy from happening to people in the future. This is our moment to rethink long-term care in New York State. The crisis in the workforce and in the quality of life for our seniors long predates the pandemic, but now we have a moment when people are paying attention and maybe we can actually make real change. One thing the pandemic has done is shown us what works and what doesn't. There was an article in Newsday just this weekend about the shape of nursing homes in the future, which may be very different from what we have seen in the past. And this task force that this bill puts together will bring together experts from many different perspectives to really chart a better path forward. So I vote aye. Thank you.
Senator May to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to count of 329, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Palumbo and White, aye 61, nays 2.
The bill is passed.
Count number 330, Senate Print 612A by Senator May, an act to amend the elder law.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator May to explain her vote.
Thank you again. So it has never been more important for residents and families in nursing homes to have a way to report issues and get answers. The Long-Term Care Ombudsman Program is mandated by the federal government. Every state has it. In New York, we have implemented it in a kind of less than ideal way, and it is primarily staffed by volunteers who are mostly retirees. They have not been able to get into nursing homes. They are vastly understaffed, and they don't really have a clear way to report the issues that they find. So this bill addresses a number of those issues. I hope in the longer term we'll be able to really overhaul it and perhaps have it staffed by paid staff in the future. But for now, this bill makes a big difference in raising the profile, giving them a hotline to the Department of Health so that they can report issues, and I hope making the whole program work better for the residents and their families. Thank you. I vote aye.
Senator May to be recorded the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to count of 330, voted in the negative, Senator Akshar, aye 62, nays 1.
The bill is passed. There's a substitution at the desk. The secretary will read.
Senator Sanders moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules, Assembly Bill number 2037, and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill 553, third reading calendar 347.
Substitution so ordered. The secretary will read.
Calendar number 347, Assembly number 2037 by Assemblymember Dinowitz, an act to amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 90th day of the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 348, Senate Print 614B by Senator May, an act to amend the public health law and the social services law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 45th day of the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator May to explain her vote.
Thank you, Madam President. Back in June, I had a letter from a constituent whose mother had gone into a nursing home for rehab after surgery. And a few weeks later, her mother died of three separate infections that had set in after the surgery. It wasn't a death from COVID-19, and she didn't blame the staff who were totally overwhelmed and had not picked up on the infection. She blamed her mother's isolation. She blamed the fact that she herself had not been able to get into the nursing home to see her mother and recognize that there was a problem. Since then, I and all my colleagues have been hearing almost daily from people in our districts and across the state who have tragic stories about isolation in nursing homes. People are dying of isolation. They're dying because they are depressed, because they're refusing to eat. They're dying because they have some underlying condition that isn't being picked up by the staff because they are so overworked. They're dying because they have cognitive decline that is rapidly accelerating as a result of their isolation. This bill would create a system where they can designate one or two people to come in and be personal care visitors on a regular basis to see them, to pay attention to what's going on with them, and to raise their quality of life. And I want to thank Statewide Senior Action and AARP and all of the advocates who have told just heartbreaking stories about this issue. I also want to thank my staff, and particularly Carol Bowl, who worked incredibly hard on this bill to make it a reality. I want to thank the governor, too, who in the last couple days has changed the regulations about nursing homes to make it easier for people to get in, which is a great step, and I welcome it. But this bill will make it a permanent thing that there will be a system for people to have visitors. It will recognize how important it is that people have the kind of personal attention that they get from family members and loved ones, but that the staff can't necessarily give them. So I welcome the governor's changes, but this bill will make a big difference for people in New York for a long time to come. So again, I vote aye, and thank you, Madam President.
Senator May to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Harkin to explain his vote.
I shifted over one due to social distancing. Can we switch the mic over here, please? All right. Thank you very much. Madam President, terrific to see you up there. I would like to, first of all, thank the majority leader and leadership for bringing this essential package to the floor. It's vitally important, and I'm glad that we're doing it as aggressively as we are. I also want to thank Senator May for her leadership on long-term care issues. And while some have resorted to demagoguery, Senator May has provided thoughtful and responsible leadership on these issues. And I thank her for that, and particularly for this bill. In her remarks, she touched upon a story about a patient whose family member was not there to be part of the care team. And so often when people are in nursing homes, a vital cog in that care team is a family member, someone who is there on a regular basis, who knows that patient and can understand how they're doing physically and how they're doing with their emotional and social well-being. We talk a lot about our students and their social emotional well-being and how that's been impacted during COVID and why we need to get them back to school. It's also so vital in our long-term care settings, and particularly with people with cognitive disabilities. And we've heard the stories of folks, whether it be in the state nursing home in Montrose or private nursing homes in the district. They have seen their family member deteriorate throughout this isolation. And that's why this bill is so important. And I thank the sponsor, I thank the leadership, I vote aye.
Senator Harkin to be recorded in the affirmative.
Thank you, Madam President. My colleagues, I rise to explain my support for this bill, which is bill number S614B by Senator May, It provides for the authorization and regulation of compassionate caregiving visitors' visitation at nursing homes and residential health care facilities. This bill moves us forward towards setting guidelines for compassionate caregiving visitation at nursing homes and residential health care facilities. Every resident in a nursing home or long-term facility has a right to benefit from family support who are an integral part of their care plan so they can live their best lives. And as we have come to terms with during this COVID-19 pandemic, this level of family care from loved ones outside can only happen if they can physically get in to visit their family relatives. But since the pandemic began, family members and even legal guardians and residents of nursing homes and other residential health care facilities have not been allowed visitation, even if they were essential part of their loved one's caregiving team pre-pandemic. The lack of physical presence of these caregivers in residents' lives has taken its toll. Advocates from across the state, including a robust family council at a facility in my district, have begun urging us to pass legislation that allows these so-called compassionate care visits. Sadly, at least one of my constituents has passed away in the meantime due to what they call, quote, failure to thrive, and others remain at risk. And I memorialize him today and hope this bill brings his family some sort of peace. The residents in these facilities are our grandparents, our mothers, our fathers, our family, and they deserve better. And I thank Senator May and others sponsoring legislation in this package for their tireless efforts on this matter. And as a government, we can and must do better by our elders and long-term care facilities to ensure they can all lead a dignified life in our state. Madam President, I proudly vote yes. Aye.
Senator Jackson to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 351, Senate Print 1783 by Senator Skoufis, an act directing the Department of Health to establish and implement an infection inspection audit.
Read the last section.
Section 6, this act shall take effect 90 days after it shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Ajabo, Giannaris, Kruger, Ork, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the result.
Aye 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 352. Senate Print 1784A by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the social services law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 90th day of the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Adabo, Giannaris, Kruger, Ork, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 354, Senate Print 3058 by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adabo, Giannaris, Kruger, Ork, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar number 354, those senators voted in a negative are Senators Helming and Palumbo, ayes 61, nays 2.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 356, Senate Print 3061A by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law.
Laid aside.
Calendar number 357, Senate Print 3185 by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 60th day of the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Adabo, Giannaris, Kruger, Ork, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 370, Senate Print 4336A by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law.
Laid aside.
Calendar number 372, Senate Print 4893 by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adabo, Giannaris, Kruger, Ork, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 372, voted in the negative, Senator Akshar, ayes 62, nays 1.
The bill is passed. Senator Giannaris, that completes the reading of today's supplemental calendar.
Thank you, Madam President. Can we now take up the controversial calendar?
The Secretary will ring the bell. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 356, Senate Print 3061A by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law.
Senator Lanza, why do you rise?
Madam President, I believe there's an amendment at the desk. I waive the reading of that amendment and ask that you recognize Senator Ort to be heard.
Thank you, Senator Lanza. Upon review of the amendment in accordance with Rule 6, Section 4B, I rule it non-germane and out of order as this time.
President, I appeal the ruling of the chair and ask that Senator Ort be recognized.
The rule has been made and recognized, and Senator Ort may be heard.
Thank you, Madam President. I rise to appeal the ruling of the chair. The proposed amendment could not be any more germane to the bill at hand, because the sponsor notes that the bill at hand is designed to bring transparency to information gathered during public health emergencies, including communicable disease outbreaks like COVID-19, and to require that facility-specific information regarding such cases and fatalities are made public. It is ironic because in the last week, the lack of transparency is how we got to where we are today in the first place. It has taken months to receive any type of transparent information from the Department of Health or the Governor's office. And when we finally did get the information, we know it was incomplete and that it was willfully incomplete. The Governor must have his emergency powers rescinded immediately, and that is what this amendment does. Since May of last year, the Republican Conference has been calling for the Governor's emergency powers to be rescinded. Our conference brought an amendment to the floor 14 times this year to rescind the power, and each and every time, the majority has voted it down. The conference brought the amendment to the floor in May after it was reported approximately 4,500 COVID patients were sent from hospitals to nursing homes. Again, majority unanimously voted it down. The conference brought the amendment to the floor in July after our conference demanded the majority use subpoena power to compel the governor and Commissioner Zucker to answer questions about the controversial March 25th order. Again, the majority voted that down. Again, this amendment has been brought to the floor 14 times this year. Today marks the 15th, but there's one difference. Today, this amendment is a bill sponsored by a member of the majority, Senator Biagi, who has had the courage to actually call out the governor and call for the ending of his emergency powers. She, along with 13 other members of the majority, signed on to a letter stating that it was time to rescind the governor's emergency powers. Today, they have the opportunity to do just that. Yes, it is agreed we need to review nursing home policies and do our job. But all these things we're passing today don't mean anything as long as the governor retains his emergency powers, because he can simply override those by executive order. And therein lies the problem. It is high time this body gets back to a co-equal branch of government. And I want to be clear, the latest scandal really has nothing to do with rescinding the governor's powers. Our conference has called for that for months. What's needed in the current moment is a federal investigation, which is ongoing. But this is about restoring the legislature to a co-equal branch of government. It's about being able to provide oversight and accountability of an executive who has shown gross disrespect for every member of this body, Democrat and Republican, and more importantly, has shown disrespect for the people that we represent and the families who have lost loved ones in nursing homes by willfully not reporting the data, by also doing so for political reasons and potentially to thwart a federal investigation. It is critical that we move and act on this bill immediately to restore the legislature again as a co-equal branch of government. For these reasons, Madam President, I strongly urge you to reconsider your ruling. We know there are 20 members of the Republican Conference and 14 of the majority who will support this today, and that's two more that is needed to pass something through this House. I urge you to reconsider the ruling, and I urge my colleagues across the aisle to support their colleague's bill and rescind the governor's powers in this House today. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Senator. I want to remind the House that the vote is on the procedures of the House and the ruling of the chair. Those in favor of overruling the chair signify by saying aye.
Madam President, we've agreed to waive the showing of hands and record each member of the minority in the affirmative on this vote.
Without objection, so ordered. Announce the results.
Ayes 20.
The ruling of the chair stands and the bill in chief is before the House. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, Wyke.
Senator Rivera to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. It is a great pleasure to be here, back in the chamber. I have not had the opportunity to be at my desk since last year. And I'm glad to be back here, not only because I love doing this job, but because this is a perfect demonstration of how exactly to do our job. Madam President, today we're passing a number of bills. This is the first one. Actually, we've already passed a few, but this is one that are all in a response to what many of us heard, not only from family members or friends or fellow New Yorkers, but also from stakeholders throughout the last year, and particularly during the series of hearings, Madam President, that we did last year in conjunction with our Assembly colleagues, that were over 30 hours, in which we were heard from witnesses who told us about all of the issues that they had to deal with their family members and their friends, their neighbors, all of the issues that existed around nursing homes and hospitals, the impact that COVID-19 had on both and that had on New Yorkers. So we have put together a few pieces of legislation, Madam President, that deal with some of the issues that we observed. And this one today, one of the ones that we're going to be considering, the one that we're looking at right now, deals directly with data. There has been a lot of conversation about this, Madam President, and I just wanted to state not only thank my colleagues for voting for this piece of legislation, but also to tell New Yorkers why it is so essential that we have correct information. For us to make decisions about how we're going to shape policy, it is important to have correct information. It is unfortunate that some folks in this building feel it's necessary to stall sharing such information. And we have fought, both publicly and privately, to make sure that this information comes to us. Some of it, I would certainly thank the Attorney General on the record for doing her job to make sure that some of this information was released. Also, folks from the Empire Center, for example, as folks who we might not agree on much, Madam President, but they certainly know how to look at data and analyze it. Ultimately, what this bill does is it would mandate the state of New York to make sure that that data is made available to the public. It would make sure that the deaths of individuals that occur in hospitals but are from patients, or shall I say residents of nursing homes, are accurately recorded. Such a thing is essential. We owe it to all of the individuals who lost loved ones during last year. I'm glad that we are doing this today. We have much more to do. We have more pieces of legislation to pass. But ultimately, we know that it is our responsibility to make sure that we protect vulnerable New Yorkers. It is what we are doing today and what we will continue to do. Thank you, Madam President. My vote is in the affirmative.
Senator Rivera to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Ayes 63.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 370, Senate print 4336A by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the public health law.
Senator Roth.
Chair, will the sponsor yield for some questions?
Will the sponsor yield?
I absolutely will, Madam President.
The sponsor will yield.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here today. And my first question for the sponsor is if you could briefly explain what this bill does and also the reasoning for the percentages within the bill.
Thank you so much. Through you, Madam President, as I stated just a minute ago, there are a few pieces of legislation which we are sponsoring and moving today, which all correspond to the issues that we saw over the last year in nursing homes around the state of New York. This bill in particular relates to a concern that is a sincere concern that exists about how much money facilities actually spend on patient care. It was a concern that made it clear to us that even though for the most part, most of the nursing homes around the state, whether they be for-profit or nonprofit, obey, or I should say, abide by a standard of spending a certain amount of money on actual patient care, we know that there are bad actors who use the opportunity and the non-clarity in the law to be able to make some money on the backs of individuals who they should be taking care of. So other states have done similar things, New Jersey, Massachusetts, but ultimately, working along with stakeholders and family members, we came up with the idea that 70% of the total revenue on a yearly basis for a nursing home should be utilized for direct patient care. We came up with that number after, again, conversations with stakeholders, and we believe that not only is it the right thing to do, but it is the right approach. And I will last point out, Madam President, that our dear governor has obviously thought that there are some good ideas here, because he took some of these ideas, not this bill though, and actually put it into his budget proposal. So I thank him for recognizing that we have a good idea, but I would say that we need to go farther than what the governor does in the budget, which is why we present this bill here, and hopefully we will be able to vote on it. Thank you, Madam President. But through you.
Through you, Madam President. Do you, as a sponsor,
will the sponsor
think that this
yield?
I will. I'm sorry, does the sponsor yield? Thank you.
Sponsor yields.
Do you think, as a sponsor, that this is similar to the medical loss ratio implemented on health plans?
Through you, Madam President, it is precisely where we got the idea. The sense here, again, is that there is an obligation for folks who are actual providers of care to provide care. And so what we're saying, Madam President, through you, is that if you are responsible for taking care of the most vulnerable of New Yorkers, that we want to make sure that as much of that dollar goes to the actual care of the individual. So it is from the medical loss ratio that we got the idea, but this relates to patient care ratio, Madam President, through you. And again, it is about making sure that as many dollars as possible go to the actual care of the patient, as opposed to the pocket of an individual who wants to take advantage of that individual.
Sponsor continue to yield.
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
The sponsor will yield.
Thank you. I perceive also that it is comparable to a medical loss ratio that's implemented on health plans. And can the sponsor please explain how he envisions nursing homes will have the ability to budget for these ratios when their revenue is dependent on the number of patients in the facility at a given time, which is constantly and routinely changing?
I should mention that just to have some numbers on the table. So the state of New York has just over 600 nursing homes. 400 of them are for-profit. And I should point out, Madam President, that over 50% of nursing homes in New York State currently abide by these percentages. They are within the range of almost 70% or just above 70% of patient care. So I would remind you, sir, everyone in the room that what we're talking about is how much money, how much revenue goes into that particular institution every year. If there are less patients on that institution in that particular year, then the revenue is going to necessarily be less. What we're ultimately talking about is 70% of whatever revenue that particular institution gets in that year needs to be utilized for direct patient care if this bill were signed into law.
Through you, Madam Chair, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, ma'am.
The sponsor yields.
Thank you. This morning in the Health Committee, Senator May, the Senate Chair on the Aging Committee, raised a concern with this bill, which I actually share. This bill does not exempt capital expenses from the ratio calculation. Let me repeat that. This bill does not exempt the capital expenses from the ratio calculation. However, throughout the pandemic, we have seen nursing homes that have had to make substantial changes and massive capital improvements in their facilities in order to protect the health and the well-being of their residents. Some of these improvements are now permanent. Would you consider, as a sponsor of this bill, amending this bill today before passing it to exempt capital expenses?
Through you, Madam President. First, it would be important to point out where this particularly came from. The senator is correct that it does not currently include capital expenses in that 70%. The reason for that is that it was pointed out to us that, see, because remember, ultimately what we're trying to do here is we're trying to identify bad actors and take away from them the ability to take advantage of the most vulnerable. So we've seen some bad actors in other states, and maybe even some in this state, who in this type of situation would actually set up shell companies for real estate companies or cleaning companies that would then actually have the money go through, the money that would ultimately go supposedly to patient care would actually go to companies that are owned, are subsidiaries of, the same owners of the facilities. To be able to avert that, we want to make sure that we eliminate that possibility. Now, I should tell you, though, that this is not a concern that is inconsequential. I will point out, actually, my colleague, not only Senator May, but I will point out particularly to Senator Gunardis. Senator Gunardis came to us with a very important distinction. He talked about a particular nursing home in his district, which was struck by Sandy, and because of where it is, was flooded after the storm. And they made some changes that then made this facility operational above sea level. Maybe that's not the correct terminology, but you know, so that it does not get flooded in whatever storm happens next. And now they're concerned about the costs that are associated with paying back for those changes which they made, which ultimately made the facility usable. So I will tell you that we're certainly considering that. There's something that we are looking into. We are going to move this bill today. However, that is something that we are looking very closely at because it is a concern that is a real one. And we ultimately do not want to create a situation in which institutions that are doing everything that they need to do to take care of their patients, for example, making sure that they do not drown if there is a storm that is coming. That is a very reasonable expectation, Madam President. And so we are certainly taking it into consideration. It is something that I'm aware of. I thank Senator Gunardis and other ones of my colleagues for bringing it up, and something that we will consider as we move towards potentially getting a bill that would be negotiated with the Assembly and the governor to be signed into law.
Thank you, Madam President. Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
Sponsor yields.
First of all, thank you for your consideration on that. I appreciate this. This is a concern across all of New York State with our nursing facilities. Throughout the year, we have seen upstate facilities that have been facing major staffing shortages when it comes to nursing homes. This has been exacerbated incredibly during the pandemic. How does this proposal account for the differing circumstances between urban and rural nursing facilities?
Well, through you, Madam President, the concern about staffing is an absolute real one in all parts of the state, but particularly in rural parts of the state, not only in your district, Senator, but also I would point out Senator May, who has been consistent in this issue, not only through this discussion, but going back for as long as she has been here, talking about the need to make sure that we put resources to identify staffing, be able to train new staffers for places that are difficult to get to, that do not have the sufficient staff at this moment. So I would say that is a concern that is ongoing. This bill would consider that the facility, because ultimately it has to do with what the facility spends. I cannot force, if a facility doesn't have access to individuals because they cannot find people to employ, right? If they have to, if they need 10 individuals to fulfill, I'm completely making this number up, but let's say that the facility needs 10 individuals that are caretakers that need to be trained, caretakers, and they can only find 8, we will not penalize them for only finding 8 of the 10 that they should. Ultimately, this refers to how much revenue they're making for that particular year. So if there's a revenue, to be able to understand this better for me, I actually just did I said if there's a nursing home, let's say a nursing home spends $1 million a year, has revenue of $1 million, right? According, if this bill passes, they would be required to have $700,000 of that $1 million be spent toward direct patient care, which could be PPE, food, housekeeping, medical cares, et cetera. Then of that total million, $400,000, which would correspond to 40% of the total, would need to be used for staffing. Now, The fact is that they might not even spend that much if they do not have, if they can't find the staff. In that sort of situation, there is flexibility for the commissioner to make certain dispensations, if you will. I'll read from the bill. It is, I'm reading from the bill. The commissioner may adjust the components of the direct patient care ratio as appropriate, based on current financial information reported by nursing homes and overall performance by the nursing home related to patient safety, direct patient care staff ratios, and quality of care. Thank you. So it allows for the from flexibility so that the commissioner may make the determination that this particular entity is not, it might not have met exactly the ratio, but is obviously doing everything that they need to be able to fulfill the requirements. So it is not a very strict, there is something that is built into the bill, so it allows for flexibility for the commissioner to make a determination in the case of a particular facility.
Yield.
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
Sponsor yields.
In the Health Committee meeting this morning, you said that this legislation is a result of conversations with stakeholders. What industry stakeholders or healthcare experts did you consult with in the preparation of this legislation?
We certainly talked to some proprietors of nursing homes. We talked to, we did talk to 1199 as well. They provided some input. We talked to some of the experts that we have in house. We talked to patient advocates. The list is, I can't tell you the exact, the list of every single person that we spoke to. But I do think that it corresponds to a good cross-section of all the folks who are interested here, whether we're talking about patient advocates or folks who represent the workers or folks who represent the owners of facilities. So I do believe that it was, that as part of this conversation, we've actually included as many opinions as necessary to be able to make an informed bill that best fits New York and actually addresses the concerns that we're trying to address here, which is ultimately, again, to make certain the facilities use their funding to take care of people and not to go into the pockets of someone.
Through you, Madam Chair, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
The sponsor yields.
Thank you. This bill was amended on Wednesday, February 17th. What does the amendment do that was drawn up on February 17th?
There are three different things that the amendment actually did. One of them, it actually made the 40%, the 40% that I referred to earlier, which is strictly about staffing. It included that. It also clarified that since there are many instances in which a facility might actually not hire people in-house, but might hire a staffing agency, that it would be done at 85%, which means that, as opposed to saying if you hire somebody, it's actually going to cost you more on a day-to-day basis as a full-time staffer, as opposed to, say, hiring a staffing agency to fulfill the requirements of the 10 people that I referred to earlier. So we talked about had that being 85% of the purchased amount would accrue towards that 40% that we're talking about. And last but not least, we talked about the excluding real estate and capital expenses, and that was based on the information that we got from other states in which shell companies are created by entities to actually be able to kind of sidestep the main purpose of the bill.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
Sponsor yields.
The governor released his 30-day amendments very late on Thursday, the 18th of February. Is the sponsor familiar with the nursing home reforms in the governor's proposed amendments?
Through you, Madam President, I believe that the governor is actually familiar with our proposals. The governor has a tendency, Madam President, to take ideas that we have, call them solutions to problems, and then just give us a watered-down version of something that we legislatively are looking to do. So I am familiar with them, Senator, because they were actually our ideas to begin with. What he has in his proposal are just watered-down versions of some of the pieces of legislation that we're passing today. So I am aware of them, but I should say that he is aware of ours. Through you, Madam President.
Through you, Madam President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
The sponsor yields.
Thank you. Is the sponsor aware that within 24 hours, the governor proposed identical ratios on nursing home revenues as proposed in your legislation?
President, I don't know the exact timeline, but that sounds about right.
Madam Chair, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
The sponsor yields.
Did the sponsor or anyone on staff consult with anyone in the governor's office or the Department of Health on this proposal prior to the release of the 30-day amendments?
I do not believe that we did, no. Again, these were ideas that we have been working on in some instances for months, and some draft of bills had been, I think we might have introduced, I have to look at the exact timeline to be completely honest, but what I can't tell you is that this is ideas that we have been working on for many months, but we did not talk to them, we did not talk to the governor. We have just, through you, Madam President, I think the folks can probably tell you I'm not necessarily the type to go around and be palling around with our good friend, the governor. So not on this issue or most other ones. So I did not consult with the governor. He certainly read our bills, though. I can tell you that. Through you, Madam President.
Through you, Madam President. Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Madam President.
The sponsor yields.
First of all, to your last comment, that makes two of us. Did anyone in the governor's office consult the sponsor or anyone on staff requesting or suggesting the amendments of this bill to be released in the 30-day amendments?
Through you, Madam President, it is actually a known fact that sometimes makes me quite sad. The governor's never called me in the 11 years that I've been in the state legislature. Not sure why you're laughing at this very sad, sad thing, Senator Janaris, but okay. So let's just say that I have not called him. He has not called me, certainly. And none of my staff has been in contact with his staff about this particular bill. We talk to the administration on all sorts of issues all the time. But on this particular issue, there has been, as far as I know, certainly, well, as far as me, no communications whatsoever. Again, which makes me sad. And as far as my staff, I can assure you none of them spoke to the governor about this bill, about these bills that we're talking about today at all.
Madam President, on the bill.
Senator Roth, on the bill.
Thank you, Senator Rivera, for answering my questions. I really appreciate it. We had a lot of questions there, and I appreciate the banter and the back and forth very much. I have some serious concerns with this bill. The circumstances surrounding how we came to be voting on this bill today in its current form, to me, looks like another Albany insider deal. How does that old saying go? If it looks like a duck, if it walks like a duck, it's a duck. We are in the middle of a global health crisis that has taken the lives of thousands of New Yorkers. Politics, as usual, is totally unacceptable. It is sickening, and frankly, it's just wrong. The governor has failed our seniors throughout this pandemic, and the majority has done nothing to intervene or to help those in our nursing homes across New York State. First, it was silence and inaction for months until hearings were scheduled for early August, with our conference continually calling for an investigation into the administration's handling of these nursing home issues. Then, one party held a questionable hearing, allowing both houses of the legislature to question the DOH commissioner for 2 hours for one day. Then they issued follow-up questions from the hearing with a 3-week deadline, which came and went, of course, with no response. Next, they complied with a secret agreement to accept the lack of this very set of responses. Now they have the supermajority and still have repeatedly refused to launch an investigation. Further, they have failed to issue subpoenas to hold this governor and the Department of Health accountable, coupled with continually voting against repealing the governor's emergency powers and taking back our duly constituted legislative authority. And now, today, February 22nd, nearly 1 year since the governor was granted his emergency powers, now this majority has decided to pass legislation which fails to address the issues that have come to light with regards to our struggling nursing homes across our great state. In general, the bills we are voting on today do nothing to address the Medicaid cuts implemented on facilities over the years or the staffing shortages they have been confronted with. Also, they do nothing to address the fact that the administration has ignored our nursing homes since the onset of this pandemic and has continually failed to provide the desperately needed resources to our nursing homes. But this bill in particular just highlights, to me, the supermajority's approach to governing as an independent body and say one thing and then turn around and do something else. This majority speaks out against the governor, but behind closed doors, I'm afraid to say, corroborates and takes their orders. New Yorkers deserve more. In particular, our seniors deserve more. And the Senate Republican Conference will continue to demand that very thing on our seniors' behalf. Thank you, Madam President.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Secretary, read the last section.
Section 2, does action take effect immediately?
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ortiz, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator Giannaris to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. I listened with amusement as Senator Rath was giving his remarks. I know he's new here, but for those of us who have been around a little bit longer, I want to give a little bit of history that the Republicans were in the majority in this chamber for most of the last decade, and there was no group that was more in this governor's pocket than the Republicans in the state Senate over that time. Not one subpoena ever issued, not one aggressive pushback against his policies, as long as you were the ones cutting the deals. So now we're sitting here actually doing something, actually making reforms to his policies, and the criticism comes. It's grossly political. This majority needs to be commended for the steps we are taking to create this oversight, and there's more to come after today. You can assure yourselves of that. I proudly vote aye, Madam President.
Senator Giannaris to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Rivera to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. I would want to thank the leader for helping lead us to this point. Now, there is much more to do. And I would say, Madam President, that had we had cooperation, had there been collaboration and cooperation with our executive, then perhaps we could have done a lot of this sooner. But I'm glad to say that based on all the work that we've done, we have a few pieces of legislation which address issues of transparency, address issues of standards of quality, of standards of safety, transparency around ownership. These are all things, as well as standards of visitation to make sure that people can visit their family members and therefore keep them healthy. That was our Senator May's bill earlier. These are all very good steps. So we have much more to do, Madam President. We know how serious this is. We understand how much we have to keep pushing on behalf of all the folks who have lost their lives, of all the people who have lost their lives. And we need to stand up for them. We believe that we are doing that, and we will continue to do that. And I'm very, very, very proud to vote for this piece of legislation today, as well as the other ones that we will do in the weeks and months to come. We understand how important it is for New Yorkers to know that we care about each and every single person who passed away. And we need to change policy to protect the most individual New York, the most fragile New Yorkers. That's what we're doing today and what we will continue to do. I vote in the affirmative. Thank you, Madam President.
Senator Rivera to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to count of 370, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Borello, Boyle, Felder, Gallivan, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Martucci, Matera, Oberacker, O'Mara, Ort, Palumbo, Rath, Steck, and White, ayes 46, nays 17.
The bill is passed. Senator Giannaris, that completes the reading of the controversial calendar.
Thank you, Madam President. Is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business at the desk.
Move to adjourn until tomorrow, Tuesday, February 23rd at 3 p.m.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Tuesday, February 23rd at 3 p.m.